contemporary Stephen Chan, professor at SOAS, who wears many hats. But we bring him here as a person who has been engaged with the Zimbabwe situation since 1980, when we first met in Zimbabwe. And he is no doubt an expert on Southern Africa and Zimbabwe in particular. And then Tendai Biti, my Mzukuru nephew. Tendai Biti, both as a person and the name, is almost synonymous with the struggle, the second struggle for liberation in Zimbabwe. I want to even argue that he's one almost indispensable to the current situation in which we're involved. Tendai is everywhere. We're together at the court on Saturday. He's just been to court now. We hope for tomorrow. He is everywhere. He's a jewel in our struggle. And we have discussions. We have Muleya Mwananyanda from Zambia, a lawyer, a deputy regional director for Amnesty International. I just want to say my condolences. Muleya just lost an aunt to COVID, a very close aunt for that matter. And we're grateful that you're able to make it all the same. And then Tiseke Kasambala from Malawi, an executive at Freedom House. But more significant for me tonight, I discovered that Tiseke is Tandika Mkandawile's niece. And we know that a few months ago we were mourning Tandika. So it's not the reason why we brought you here, Tiseke. We brought you in your own right in the first instance. And then my brother from down south, Greg Mills, former director of CEO of Southern African Institute of International Affairs, now director of Brentus Foundation. We bring him here also because he has been writing a lot with one Hartley on Zimbabwe and on South Africa's policies to Zimbabwe in a very critical fashion. But he's also here to represent our old man, President Obasanjo, was unable to make it, but sent a note saying, look, Greg will represent me. So I'm also suggesting that you speak twice, Greg. But anyway, the old man thinks that you are sufficient to represent both yourself and him. And of course, Tendai, BT, Greg Mills, and Obasanjo produced a book recently on democracy, which we were privileged to launch at Sapes last year. I don't know what happened to Malema. First of all, I'd want to say that he let us down because he did not confirm. We invited him, but he did not confirm. So no way, no show. But we have another of our colleagues, Patrick Smith, the editor of Africa Report. And again, someone who's very, very familiar with Africa, not to mention Zimbabwe. He was also technical advisor to the UN panel on the exploitation of mineral and other resources in the DRC in the 90s, and is the author of Who's Who in Southern Africa. Patrick, welcome. So, I now introduce Valid Gonda, our very able moderator, to take us through the discussion.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mandaza, for those introductions. And hello to viewers in Zimbabwe and around the world. I am Violet Gonda, and welcome to the fifth in the Sapes Trust Policy Dialogue series on Zimbabwe's deepening crisis. And we are, of course, looking for the way forward. As you heard from Dr. Mandaza, today's theme is, what will it take to reach a settlement in Zimbabwe? And the fundamental questions we'll be asking are, is the Zimbabwean crisis sufficient that it requires international pressure? What should we expect from the regional and international community? We are live streaming as usual on the Sapes Trust Facebook page, and participants watching on Zoom can type their questions for our speakers here or raise your hands during the open forum. We will start with the presentations from our three panelists, Todd Moss, Stephen Chan, and Tendai Biti, and then contributions from a number of selected discussants, including Muleya Mwananyanda from Zambia, Tiseke Kasambala from Malawi, Greg Mills, South Africa, and Patrick Smith in the United Kingdom. It's now my pleasure to introduce our first guest speaker, Todd Moss, who is a non-resident fellow at the Center for Global Development. He will be interrogating the US position on Zimbabwe while also making his own recommendations. Todd?
Great. Well, thank you. Thank you, Violet. And thank you, Ibo, for that very generous introduction. I'm honored to be joined by such illustrious colleagues. And I want to thank also Sapes Trust. You know, I started my career in Zimbabwe 30 years ago as a student in Harare, studying Shona at Ranch House College and learning about Zimbabwe's politics and history. And I visited Sapes Trust many times for my research on South African destabilization in the region. And I'm grateful for the chance to talk with everyone who's logged in today. So look, this is a big question. What will it take to reach a settlement in Zimbabwe? First and foremost, you know, any settlement is going to depend on the choices and decisions of Zimbabweans. It's not going to be decided by outsiders. But I do think I can contribute to this discussion by sharing the perspective of the United States. And the U.S. matters because it has long been a friend and partner of the Zimbabwean people. The U.S. is the largest provider of humanitarian assistance to the country. And the U.S. is a member of the Paris Club of Creditors and a shareholder of the international financial institutions with whom Zimbabwe is in billions of dollars in deep arrears. And any genuine recovery in Zimbabwe will require debt forgiveness and new loans. Any debt forgiveness or new loans will therefore require U.S. agreement. And thus, any reform process that's supposed to undergird new lending will have to be convincing to the United States. So if that sounds a little grim, let me start with some good news. The first piece of good news is that the US policy on Zimbabwe has been very clear and very consistent for the past two decades. The Zimbabwe Democracy and Recovery Act, called ZEDERA, passed way back in 2001, and it was just updated in 2018. Everyone can read it. Google will help you find it. It's only four pages long, and it's very clear. It says that U.S. support for Zimbabwe is contingent on good governance and a return to the rule of law. There's a lot of misinformation out there about what ZEDERA is, so I would encourage you to have a look for yourself. More good news, U.S. policy towards Zimbabwe is very bipartisan. It has been very stable from President Bush to President Obama to President Trump. And I can tell you that it does not matter who wins the election in the United States in November, U.S. policy towards Zimbabwe will remain steady. And one last piece of good news, Washington, D.C. pays very close attention to Zimbabwe. It knows Zimbabwe's history, and the U.S. has not been fooled by false promises. We watched very closely in 2008. I was in the State Department then during that period. We closely watched the government of national unity. We saw what could happen in Zimbabwe when you have a competent finance minister in charge. We saw the recovery that was possible. But ultimately, we saw what happens when the ruling party refuses to share real power. And we watched the 2013 elections, the coup in 2017, and of course, the election in 2018. Now, here's the bad news. After at least five recent opportunities to do so, the view from Washington is that there is no reason to believe that ZANU-PF can reform itself. Unlike some other governments, the US has never bought into the propaganda of the so-called new dispensation. I hope Stephen will tell us more about what the British Embassy in Harare may have been thinking, but I can say that the US very clearly was never fooled. And as Ibo mentioned, I was back in Harare in May 2018, ahead of the election, a group of former US diplomats came for an assessment. And we, the group of us, came away convinced, and I should say unanimously convinced, that the ruling party was perpetuating three charades, three different false campaigns to trick the international community and the Zimbabwean people that things were changing. Now, we concluded that each of the three charades were not real because there were lots of clear, easy things the government could do if it was genuine, but instead the government kept doing the opposite. The three charades are: one, political reform. The elections, from our perspective, were a farce, from the voter roll to the open intimidation of opposition supporters to the post-election violence. The second charade was on economic reform. Open for business, it was a nice slogan, but virtually no meaningful steps were actually taken to open the economy or to tackle corruption. And third, the third facade was national reconciliation. It seemed to us like obvious political theater. There was no genuine intention of grappling with the ghosts of 2008, 2005, and certainly not Gukurahundi. And we concluded that the US government should be skeptical and move very cautiously. Now, I wish we had been wrong. Sadly, I think we were proven right. Sadly, the entire world now knows that the promises of reforms and national healing were false promises. In fact, they were specifically designed not to change Zimbabwe, but actually to shield those in power, to further entrench them, and most obviously to make them richer. And sadly, those same three facades today, August 2020, still seem to be the same plan. So any potential settlement going forward would need to convince the Zimbabwean people that the prospect of reform was real. And for the United States, we would have to see genuine steps forward that reforms were going to happen. I don't think Washington will ever agree to a repeat of the government of national unity or a repeat of 2018. And the recent use by the government of Washington lobbyists to promote the poll ad suggests that they still think we're going to be easily tricked if they just keep trying. Now, the US will look to Zimbabwe's civil society. We will take important signals from the people of Zimbabwe. We will especially watch the movement and behavior of the diaspora. If the diaspora is not coming home with their feet or with their money, it is not a sign of confidence that things are really changing. So to be clear, the US will not rubber stamp another round of pretending that is really just another attempt by the same small circle of people to hold on to power, the same small group of people who caused the country's crisis in the first place. So let me conclude by saying the big question for any settlement from the outside, it's actually quite a simple question, even though it's a big issue. Will the settlement advance the causes of democracy, national healing, and economic recovery? Or will a settlement only serve to further entrench and enrich those who are currently in power? Why don't I stop there? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Todd, for those remarks. Let me start by asking you a general question. Is America the best place to be lecturing the world at this point? Because many say democracy advocates have been betrayed by the US current administration, and that the behavior of President Trump is similar to that of President Emmerson Mnangagwa in terms of attacking the press and compromising democratic institutions. What's your reaction to this?
Look, the United States is very far from perfect. We always have been. And I think that we try as hard as we can to be honest about our shortcomings. I think the public outcry over the George Floyd killing and the subsequent Black Lives Matter movement has really, you know, this is going to fundamentally change the United States. And, you know, this is an issue that all societies are grappling with racism, and we need to grapple with this honestly. Yes, I do think that the rhetoric and the actions of the Trump administration have undermined our standing on human rights and democracy around the world, including in Zimbabwe. But I would say none of that excuses the faults of the American government or the American problems in America's society cannot be used as an excuse for the Zimbabwean government to violate their own constitution, the human rights of their people, and to continue to destroy the Zimbabwean economy. We will be trying to deal with our own problems, just like all countries are dealing with the current crisis. But I don't think that you're going to see the United States abandon its long-term commitment to good governance, to democracy, to human rights, and especially to the economic opportunity of freedom that all people around the world aspire to.
And on the issue of sanctions, critics actually say that sanctions are useless, that they are hurting ordinary people. And Zimbabwe has had sanctions for 20 years, and they say, what did they achieve? Your thoughts on this?
Sure. So I think it's pretty clear you can use Google again and go to the U.S. Treasury website and see the names of the people who are sanctioned. These are not trade sanctions like against South Africa during apartheid. These are not general sanctions against Zimbabweans, except those specific companies and names on that list. And just yesterday, two additional names were added to that list and 32 names were taken off, which I think should be a sign that the US again is paying attention and trying to shape the sanctions regime to be updated as Zimbabwe's situation evolves. But I also think that the issue of whether sanctions have been helpful or not to Zimbabwe's trajectory, as you suggest, we've had sanctions in place for 20 years and Zimbabwe's situation has mostly gotten worse over those 20 years. Sanctions are a relatively blunt tool. I think at this stage, the policy question for us now is not, it's not, can we go back to 2001 and do something differently? I think we all wish we could do that. The question for policymakers in 2020 is, and this comes back to my final question, will lifting sanctions in 2020, will that advance the causes of democracy, national healing, and economic recovery? Or will that benefit those that are currently entrenched in power and enriching themselves? My personal view, and this is a policy decision, I'm not in government now. My personal view is that if the US lifted all sanctions right now and relieved that pressure, that would be a tremendous propaganda victory for the current regime. And it would be interpreted by many as a signal that the US no longer cared about democracy and human rights, and that is quite simply not true. One last thing I'll just note is if you read the language on the last couple of sanctions additions, including the action that was taken yesterday, you'll notice that there's a very strong new emphasis on corruption. And the US is definitely taking a much sharper lens on looking to see which public officials and their allies are stealing money from the Zimbabwean people and using that to justify additional sanctions, because that's where we can use the tools of the global banks to try to limit their ability to steal money from ordinary people.
Okay, last question for you before I move to Professor Stephen Chan. You mentioned that the US is unlikely to support another GNU, if I heard you correctly. But what about the positions that have been outlined by Dr. Ibo Mandaze in his opening remarks about the NCP. What do you think the US government will support an initiative like that?
So look, I think that the answer is going to be that the US would assess the options when they see them. The US is not going to dictate the terms of a settlement to the Zimbabwean people. That will be up to Zimbabweans to negotiate. But the US will take an independent view about whether this is a genuine transition, this is a genuine opportunity to get Zimbabwe back on track. I think the starting point is going to be deep skepticism because of the previous periods. We would want to be convinced that this process was going to lead to all of the positive outcomes we want to see, and not, as the GNU was ultimately, just another mechanism for a small cabal of ZANU-PF to cling to power and to get richer. So that is the trick, and I'd say my colleagues in government will definitely want to hear from civil society, from the different opposition parties, and from the diaspora. If those groups all believe that it's for real, and we're seeing concrete steps, not just words and promises and billboards, but actual concrete steps, I'm very confident that the US would get behind and support that. But before billions of dollars are wiped off of the books, and billions more put into the Zimbabwean economy, we're going to need a much higher degree of confidence that those dollars will be for good and not be for deepening the crisis.
We'll certainly come back to you later, but I can see there are quite a few responses in our Zoom chat. So we'll come back and ask you some of those questions later. But let me turn to Professor Stephen Chan, who is a professor of world politics at SOAS University here in London. He's going to start with his presentation on UK policy on Zimbabwe. Professor Chan?
Hello, I'm delighted to be here with all of you and to see many old friends again, and to be able to participate in this particular seminar. I think that what we've got in the United States is a very, very difficult, in the United Kingdom is a very difficult situation, where the United Kingdom finds itself embattled on a number of fronts. It has a COVID crisis, of course, but what is also happening is that there's an economic meltdown in the United Kingdom itself because of the mishandling of the Brexit issue. So you have a distraction in terms of being able to concentrate on key parts of the world. And I think I have to say quite bluntly at this point in time, Africa in general does not really feature in high level United Kingdom policy formulation. And Zimbabwe hardly features at all in the deliberations of the government, in the Foreign and Commonwealth Office. And in fact, Africa in general, as far as the Foreign and Commonwealth Office is concerned, has been to a certain extent downgraded. There's been a huge rotation of ministers. These are junior ministers responsible for Africa. Each one seems to last not much more than a year, and then they're rotated. It seemed very, very much as some kind of training ground for the possibility of future promotion. And I think that most of the incumbents look at it very much as a passing through portfolio so they can be promoted elsewhere. So the whole idea of having consistent developing policy on a country like Zimbabwe, that's actually not there in the United Kingdom right now. And there's been a very deliberate taking the eye off the political ball. The current ambassador to Zimbabwe, Melanie Robinson. She's an aid expert. She came out of the Department for International Development. And this marked a departure from the kind of ambassadors that the United Kingdom used to send to Zimbabwe. And people like Catriona Lang, for instance, was very, very clearly someone who was enmeshed in the political world, in the diplomatic world, in the world of high politics. And the same with Deborah Brunet, before, the same with Mark Canning before. So there was a very deliberate sea change, a very deliberate change of policy towards Zimbabwe, almost as if to say, we're going to give up trying to fix the problems down there, and let's just try to do as best we can in humanitarian terms. Now, the last ambassador to Zimbabwe, Catriona Lang, became very controversial, of course, because of the messaging that she was meant to have been sending home to Whitehall. These messages have been, to a certain extent, misinterpreted. I was very, very close to the Foreign Office and, in fact, to Catriona Lang at that point in time. And the kinds of messages being sent back were that in the power struggles of Zimbabwe, the United Kingdom government would benefit more from a Mnangagwa administration as opposed to a Grace Mugabe administration. And this was purely a pragmatic piece of advice. The United Kingdom didn't feel it could deal with a Grace Mugabe type of administration. In the event it was a Mnangagwa presidency, the actual coming to power of Mnangagwa took the United Kingdom by surprise. They weren't expecting the movements that led to the fall of Robert Mugabe. And at that point in time, you had a new young minister for Africa, Rory Stewart, who basically made up policy on the spot. He invited me into his office to consult. That very, very evening, he was on a plane to Zimbabwe to attend the inauguration of Mnangagwa. But this was something which did not necessarily reflect the collected wisdom of his seniors in the Foreign and Commonwealth Office and in government as a whole. Even so, he was very much required to put to Mnangagwa a very clear message that there would be no lifting of pressure from the United Kingdom without very, very clear signals in terms of civil liberties and in terms of political rights. Now, I know exactly what was in his speech because I helped him write it. And it was laying down a marker that any kind of re-engagement with the Mnangagwa administration was conditional. And those two conditions were, let me reiterate this, to do with civil liberties and to do with political rights. Now, insofar as the United Kingdom pays any attention to Africa and to Zimbabwe in the middle of its current crises, then it's very, very much looking at two things. Are those conditions being fulfilled? And as with the United States, the judgment would be no, they're not. The other thing they're looking at is Zimbabwe about to head into another humanitarian crisis, particularly in terms of healthcare, and particularly in terms of malnutrition, needing to rely on food relief from the international community once again. This is where Melanie Robinson, the ambassador, is very, very well placed precisely to advise the government as to what kind of humanitarian relief the United Kingdom can provide. Insofar as there's any foreign aid budget left in the United Kingdom, I think that there'll be a very deep anxiety to try to do something to help the Zimbabwean people. The other thing I should mention from the point of view of the United Kingdom is, of course, the very, very large Zimbabwean diaspora. It waxes and wanes in terms of its size, but of course it's been huge from time to time. And there are Zimbabwean hotspots, as it were. There are towns and suburbs which are like little Harare. You hear Shona being spoken on the streets. And they're phenomenally well organized. And they're very well organized in terms also of their political views. There used to be a very strong ZANU-PF presence among the diaspora. That's faded quite noticeably. This is not to say that there's a greater sympathy or a greater degree of support for the MDC, but there certainly has been a huge attrition of support and tolerance of what's happening back home in terms of the ZANU-PF government. And this is where I think that Dr. Mandaza was perfectly correct in his introductory remarks in emphasizing that we should watch for the Zimbabwean Lives Matter movement, which has begun and which has in a very short time begun to attract a huge following in the United Kingdom, but also in the United States. What I find quite interesting, particularly in the United States with Zimbabwean Lives Matter, is the number of Black American celebrities that have now been drawn to support Zimbabwean Lives Matter. Once ZANU-PF starts losing the international Black youth vote as it were. This is going to have a huge effect because these are important voters for any kind of government seeking election or re-election. They're going to have policies that say we're not going to lift sanctions, for instance. And they're going to have policies that basically say that civil liberties, lives matter. Suppression, repression, killing in the streets are precisely those things that will be alerted to governments from young people, young Black people in Europe and in America, that there can be no toleration for these kinds of policies from President Mnangagwa. So it's a new form of civil society. I'm not sure if this has really sunk in deeply as yet in terms of MDC thinking, because I've yet actually to see a coordinated, deeply thought out, multi-platform, electronic effort to capture international civil society. But that really is the future, with the reduction in terms of physical space because of troops on the streets, police on the streets, beatings, killings, abductions, that kind of thing. The new sphere of activism is very, very much online. And that's going to grow and grow and grow and shape international public opinion. It might not change the government in Zimbabwe, but what it means increasingly, and I'm actually going to make this into a very firm prediction, this mantra of Zimbabwe being open for business, this is rhetoric, of course, as we've been discussing, but it will be rhetoric that will sound more and more hollow in the face of the success of electronic campaigns like Zimbabwean Lives Matter. No self-respecting corporation of any kind of monetary value is going to invest in Zimbabwe. That's American corporations and that's British corporations. From the point of view of the business community in the United Kingdom, when I speak to them, there's absolutely no confidence that Zimbabwe really is open for business. Everyone thinks they'll lose their money. Everyone thinks that their money would not be safe, that it would be stolen. In other words, the whole climate for investment is no longer something which is in any way attractive. And public relations rhetoric of the sort that the president would be purveying simply is not going to work. In other words, as with political matters, political liberties, civil liberties, the test is, what's the reality? If this reality is not apparent, if it's not real, then from the United Kingdom, at least, they'll stand pretty much with their American cousins and not want to go there. So that's what I wanted to say at the outset.
Okay. No, thank you, Professor Chan. Just to go back a bit to what you said right at the beginning, you say UK communications are largely confined to humanitarian work, if I heard you correctly. But many would still argue that Britain did facilitate the 2017 coup. So my question then will be, to what extent is the UK stance on the deteriorating situation in Zimbabwe constrained by its culpability in the November 2017 coup? And what are the current lines of communications between Harare and London right now?
Basically, just starting with your last question first, the lines of communication are very, very modest, they're very low key. There's finally a new ambassador from Zimbabwe to London. He's not been particularly active. So that what you have is a presence at formal ambassadorial level, but no real engagement with Whitehall of any kind of meaning. And Whitehall doesn't actually want to engage itself beyond a certain very limited point to do with being able to honor protocol and things of that nature. In terms of culpability for 2017, I actually differ from some received wisdom that somehow the United Kingdom was in some way involved. As I said, they were very, very surprised. They preferred Mnangagwa to Grace Mugabe. They were happy to see the end of Robert Mugabe. It was almost like a personal feud between the two countries in the personalities of the president of Zimbabwe and, of course, prime ministers like Tony Blair. But I don't think anyone plotted or was in any way directly culpable for the removal of Mugabe. If you're going to say which government internationally was in some way culpable, then you're looking at my other, as it were, hat, that is the Chinese hat. Basically, I think, my very strong suspicion is that Beijing gave the green light, not in any active way, using basic Chinese modest language, very cultural attribute, just saying, well, it's your business, so go ahead, but just for some strange reason, we're not going to make any noise if you choose to go ahead. Don't forget, Chiwenga was in Beijing just before all of this started happening. So you have, as it were, all kinds of rumors about which government was more culpable than the other. Certainly, I would say, from the point of view of the British, they were pleasantly surprised, but very much surprised. I don't think they were involved. I think it's true to say that they preferred Mnangagwa, but that's because, and I'll use this term, a strong term, that's because they detested Grace Mugabe.
So, you know, you brought in the Chinese element, and Dominic Mutanga on Zoom actually asks, what role do you see China playing in either mediating or perpetuating the current crisis in Zimbabwe?
Well, it's been a little while since I've been in Beijing, but on a recent visit to Beijing, they took me aside and showed me their figures on Zimbabwe. Very, very deep financial figures and calculations. And I looked up from these figures, from all of these papers they gave me, and I said, so you know it's a basket case? And they said, yes, of course we know it's a basket case. And the basic position was, they're still going to help in terms of development projects, for instance, infrastructural projects, agricultural projects, and they see a need for that. They're not going to give budgetary standby support. They're not going to bail out the government. And apart from some certain gestures about writing off one or two loans, they're not going to write off a huge number of loans. Now, when Mnangagwa came to power, our estimates in the Foreign and Commonwealth Office was that Zimbabwe owed $9 billion immediately that required to be repaid out of a possible $35 billion and rising to the rest of the international community. Those were the most modest estimates that we were able to come up with. Now, $9 billion, the Chinese could have just given that, just like that. It would not have been a problem for them. You need $9 billion, here's $9 billion. But they themselves were not convinced that the Zimbabwean government would introduce fiscal transparency. If you look at what the Chinese did in Angola, they basically said, we'll keep investing, but we want to have transparency in your national budget allocations. The national budget used to be one gigantic slush fund without any subheads. But the Chinese basically imposed subheads, as it were, on the national budget. So it could not just be a slush fund open for corruption. It's still, of course, a corrupt country. But transparency, at least in a superficial sense, was implanted into the Angolan fiscal situation, and the Chinese were able to continue their relationship with the government of Angola on a financial basis. There's heavy Chinese investment there. That's not going to come to Zimbabwe because they're not satisfied with your fiscal probity, with your fiscal discipline. When you look at the way that the Chinese are acting right now, it's not any longer state-to-state giving of money, that the state provides liquidity, is increasingly being done by Chinese banks. There might be state banks or banks with majority state holding, but a bank is a bank is a bank is a bank. It's got to get its money back. It's got to impose fiscal conditions, repayment, servicing, all of those kinds of things, reliability of expectation in terms of returning money. Now, with this basic lack of confidence coming out of Beijing towards the current government, they're also not particularly minded to act as a mediator. Let someone else do that. We've put so much into this country right from the very beginning. We helped ZANU-PF with the liberation struggle. We trained their soldiers. We equipped the ZANRA army. We've stood by them all of these years. We're not removing our support, but we're not increasing it. And we're not going to get our hands any deeper into the Zimbabwean mud. Now, they'll never say it like that, but I'm willing to bet my hat, or bet Tendai's hat, if I could steal it from him at some point in time. He always wears very nice trilbies, that the Chinese, behind closed doors, think along those lines.
Mm. Well, we'll hear from Tendai just now. Last question for you, and it's a WhatsApp message, and it goes with the last sentiments that you talked about in terms of mediation. Who could be the right person or country to do this? So the question is: UK has had an important role in Lancaster. What about now? What about bringing the political parties to the table? What can you say briefly on that one before we move on to Tendai?
We don't have a foreign minister like Lord Carrington anymore. He was really a one-off, whether you loved him or loathed him. And I had a love-hate relationship with him myself. But really, we have nobody of that kind of stature, nobody with that kind of inclination. If you're looking for international intervention, then someone like a special representative of the United Nations Secretary General, that could be something to aim for. But I would not be in total favor of that. A special envoy, a special representative of the chair of the African Union would signal that Africa was trying to deal with its own problems, trying to deal with its own members. Or maybe a past president or chairman of the African Union. Somebody like Jean Ping, for instance, from Gabon, whom I regarded very, very highly, and not just because he was half Chinese, but someone of that kind of stature, someone who would come in and be able to talk a language that was understandable to both of the main sides. But I don't think that even if you found a mediating figure, that the two major parties are at this stage interested in mediation. They're playing a game of attrition against each other at this moment in time.
Okay. No, thank you, Professor Stephen Chan. Now, let me move on to Tendai Biti, who's the MDC Vice President. Tendai, can you give us your position from the opposition point of view?
Well, thank you very much, and good evening to the viewers and listeners, and my good friends, Todd and Greg. I think the question demands a certain critical answers. And the first question is ZANU-PF ready to talk? And what is ZANU-PF? Who is ZANU-PF? Are there incentives for ZANU-PF to talk? What are the drivers of any dialogue? Has Zimbabwe and the two main parties, the MDC Alliance and ZANU-PF, have we reached a mutually self-hating status quo, which leaves the parties with no choice but to dialogue and talk, which is what we did in 2007 and in 2008 when President Mugabe was still around and President Tsvangirai was still around. This time around, I don't think that ZANU-PF is ready to talk. I think that the biggest challenge and the elephant in the living room is the complete takeover of the Zimbabwean state by the military, the rise of the securocratic state, which since November 2017, you have seen this massive authoritarian consolidation. You have seen massive closure of political spaces in a manner that is unprecedented. The current goings on now of abductions, arrest of journalists, arrest of pastors, of lawyers, no one is safe, is unprecedented. It's almost like you are dealing with a totally deranged elite in ZANU-PF that is controlling the state. But there's something that is happening other than authoritarian consolidation. There's something else that is happening, which is an incentive for the retention of the status quo. and the disincentive for change, for transformation, and for dialogue. This thing is the massive looting that is currently taking place in Zimbabwe at the present moment. I chair the Public Accounts Committee of Parliament. I've never seen such massive looting done directly from Treasury, from the Ministry of Finance. The Minister of Finance is traditionally a gatekeeper. And when you have a situation where the gatekeeper becomes the gatecrasher, you have a problem. In some of the figures, $2.7 billion US dollars stolen in 2017. And in 2017, on one day alone, the 27th of December, 2017, $1.5 billion US dollars was stolen directly from Treasury. I mean, for Christ's sake, who steals on Christmas Day? 2018, $3.5 billion US dollars was stolen. Then you have what they've been stealing from the Reserve Bank, the US dollar, what they've been stealing through Command Agriculture, what they've been stealing through fuel, what they've been stealing through procurement, what they've been stealing through subsidies. It's a dog's breakfast, and one which not many dogs would touch. Look at the way they're stripping commodities, minerals, and so forth. Kudata Gwire and Sakunda now have their hands in virtually every sector of our commodities, whether it's platinum, whether it's gold, whether it's chrome, whether it's diamonds, their ugly hands are there. And Emmerson Mnangagwa is right at the center of this. They've taken over the transport, the entire transportation or public transportation of Zimbabwe. The monopoly has been given to ZUPCO, the Zimbabwe United Passenger Omnibus Company. Who is controlling that? It's actually Emmerson Mnangagwa and Kudasi Company, Lantela Ventures. So they've got their ugly hands in every facet of the economy. And I don't think there's any incentive for them to dialogue and to negotiate. As Michelle Wong wrote in relation to Kenya, it's their time to eat. And when they are eating, I don't think they would want to to depart from the political scene. A third disincentive for departure is the elite rupture inside ZANU-PF itself. So apart from the state being an arena of accumulation, it's also an arena for safety. As long as you are president, you can control the armed section of the state for your own security. No one is going to come to your door to prosecute you. So holding on to power, fragile and slippery as it is, it becomes a source of personal security, family security, tribal security. So in my respectful submission, the drivers of change in Zimbabwe, which I'll talk about, are at the present moment outweighed by the regime retention agenda, or more appropriately, the regime survival agenda, and that doesn't bode well for Zimbabwe. What are the drivers for change, and how do we make the drivers for change, for transformation, for dialogue? How do we make them outweigh the regime survival or regime change agenda? How do we get to a stage where we can actually dialogue? The drivers for change are, number one, the complete economic mismanagement by this regime. Look at the total mismanagement of monetary policy and the foreign exchange regime. They introduced the auction rate a few weeks ago, but the auction rate itself is increasing exponentially, simply because you can't control a product that you don't have, and we're not producing. There's no productivity. So yesterday's auction rate, it was 1:8. The black market rate is 1:105. In a few weeks' time, the auction rate will be on 1:105, and the parallel rate will keep on growing faster than the auction rate. The source of all Zimbabwe's economic stability is, of course, a lack of fiscal discipline and lack of fiscal consolidation. whilst nominally they appear to have surpluses, the deficit is being monetized and hidden through the Reserve Bank, which has started printing money and is increasing a broad money supply. Only a week ago, they signed an agreement, a global compensation fund agreement with the erstwhile farmers of US $3.5 billion. That has not been brought to Parliament. That has not been approved by Parliament, but that will impose serious fiscal obligations on the Republic of Zimbabwe, as half of that amount has to be paid within 12 months from now. The crisis is also increased, has also come at a cost. They've had to put soldiers on the streets. They've had to cancel the leave of every policeman, every CIO, every soldier. That has come at a cost. They've had to increase the salaries of civil servants. And so the budget deficit is looming. And as all of us know, it is not the budget deficit per se which is a problem. It's how they monetize the budget deficit, how they cover the war. And if you cover the war through creative extra legal means, like the printing of money, you've got a problem. So in short, economic mismanagement is a driver for change. Corruption itself is a driver of change. Our people are very, very angry. Number three is the violence on our people. Recently, we had those three girls, Netsai Maruova, Joanna Mamombe, Cecilia Chimbiri. Those girls were sexually, abused. We had young Mucheiwa in Bulawayo, again, viciously assaulted and sexually abused. We've got journalists that are in hiding. We've got complete capture of state institutions. I'm a practicing lawyer. Going to court is a nightmare because the formalities, because appearing in court is just a formality. You know the outcome, and it's brazen, and they don't care. So in my submission, there is an obligation on the citizen, including the MDC Alliance, of keeping on pressure against the regime is permitted in terms of Section 59 of the Constitution of Zimbabwe. With all the attendant risks, with all the attendant dangers. So 31 July was fantastic. Some will argue that it flopped. I would submit that it didn't, because the state was stretched. The stretch was exposed, and they failed to meet the test. You also have impending constitutional amendments. Emerson is amending the constitution to consolidate his own hold on power and to recreate an imperial president. So the constitutional project is another one that is creating an incentive for change, because the citizen is very unhappy with the constitutional amendments. So there's an obligation on the citizen to keep on pumping the pressure. There's an obligation on the MDC Alliance to actually provide the requisite leadership. But most importantly, there's an obligation on every Zimbabwean of understanding that he or she has an obligation to act. The next critical issue is that even if we put pressure, there has to be external agency on the Zimbabwean crisis. There has to be external a referee. So it is going to be very critical for the region to act. It is going to be very critical for Cyril Ramaphosa to act. And I think it's disappointing at the present moment that we haven't seen the leadership that we expect of Cyril Ramaphosa. We haven't seen SADC behaving and acting in the same way that other regional bodies, in particular the West African regional body, has been acting. And so SADC itself has become a hotspot of nasty characters. Take John Pombe Magufuli in Tanzania. Take Edgar Chagwa Lungu in Zambia. Take Filipe Nyusi in Mozambique, and our very own Emerson Dambudzo Mnangagwa. So there is an obligation on SADC. There is an obligation on international law to provide not just a deterrence to the kind of fascist madness that is taking place in Zimbabwe, but also the kind of incentives that are necessary to ensure that there is order in Zimbabwe, there is stability. And my hope is that with the world paying attention closely on Zimbabwe as it is at the present moment, that the UN, and in particular the UN Security Council, take notice. So my submission is that the primary obligation of obtaining the change we need lies on Zimbabwe. But Zimbabweans alone, without the agency and external refereeing of the regional community, it won't be enough. In 2007, 2008, we got both. So a national transitional mechanism is something that we support, but it must be based on the agenda of reform, on the agenda of transformation. And we must avoid the mistakes we made in 2007, 2008, when we created the government of national unity by focusing and creating an agreement that was essentially a peace truce to stop the violence and the killings of 2008. This time around, we are wiser. We have learned from our mistake. We must actually craft an agreement that focuses on real reform. And real reform must start with, how do we deal with the security question in Zimbabwe? How do we ensure that the military go back to the barrack? How do we ensure that the military comply with Section 205 of the Constitution and respect an elected civilian order? Secondly, how do we deal with the scourge of state capture? In my respectful view, corruption has become such a key issue in the Zimbabwean discourse that to move forward, you have to put it high up on the agenda of any meaningful discussion on reform, on transformation. So after the security question, after the military question, you have to have discussions on security, on corruption, because corruption and the military factor are inextricably linked. You'll find the same characters, the same cabal involved in both sides of the coin. Then, of course, we need political reform. We need constitutional reform. We need legislative reform. And perhaps most importantly, how do we recover and rehabilitate the economy? Because the ordinary citizen out there is suffering. 95% of Zimbabweans are unemployed. 7 million Zimbabweans are food vulnerable. 5 million Zimbabweans have to receive international humanitarian assistance. 79% of Zimbabweans are living in extreme poverty, surviving on less than US 35 cents a day, what we here in Zimbabwe call tsaona. So then, of course, you've got the crisis, the COVID pandemic, which has been seriously been mishandled and mismanaged by this regime. So we have a number of issues that need address, but in my opinion, we are still far. Because you've got a group of deranged individuals who are oblivious to the plight of Zimbabweans, who are concerned with two things and two things alone: A, the power retention agenda, and two, state capture or corruption. And the head boy of that group is Emmerson Mnangagwa. I'll stop here for now.
Thank you very much. You've touched on quite a few issues, and I can see that the chat room is quite busy. There are quite a lot of questions from people, so I'll ask some. The first one is from T. Lodlo, who says, military has always been an extension of ZANU-PF, and I would actually want to also add a question to his observation, saying that, so what do you propose to do in terms of bringing the military to the table? Do you think the military should be brought to the table, since there is such a significant player in this all, in the saga?
Well, I think it's a dangerous precedent to actually bring the military on the table. I think it's a dangerous precedent. It's an unconstitutional precedent, and I think it must be avoided. But there must be dialogue. There must be dialogue that takes care of military concerns and military issues. In 2008, in April 2008, after we the MDC had won that election, and Morgan Tsvangirai had beaten President Robert Mugabe, the military sent envoys to talk to Morgan Tsvangirai. And there were about six key issues that they raised with the MDC at the time. The first one was that were concerns about transitional justice. Won't a future government prosecute us for human rights abuses that we have made to commit in the past? And we gave an assurance on an open, transparent program of transitional justice. The second question was, will a future government not dispossess them of the proceeds of their illicit or legal business activities? The third question was, will a future government not dispossess them of their land and not reverse the land question? And of course, the answer is obvious. No one wants to reverse the land question. And I don't think it's possible to reverse the land reform program anyway. The fourth or fifth question was whether those of them who wanted to leave the country would be allowed to leave the country. And of course, there's freedom of movement in Zimbabwe. The next question were their own conditions of services, decent salaries, and so forth. Again, obvious question. Next question was their pensions. They wanted a guarantee on their pensions, that their pensions would not be affected. Again, not a problem. The last question was whether they will be allowed to participate in the spheres of the economy, including joining the civil service, should they quit the military. So my submission is that their concerns must be attended to. They're an important stakeholder. But I believe strongly that by and large, the majority of the military will accept the dictates of the constitution. But you still have a few, and the few are largely people in the military who participated in the liberation struggle, who feel that this is our thing, and to use the local language, and that generation, the liberation generation, is a challenge, not just in the military, but in the length and the breadth of Zimbabwe, because it's a generation that is still fighting a war that finished 40 years ago. It is a generation that is driven by entitlement. It is a generation that is driven by impunity. It is a generation that is driven by an extractive mindset. It is a generation that is driven by a messianic mindset. We liberated you. We are your own Jesus. So nothing, there's no Zimbabwe without us. So it's a challenge that we have to face. It's a challenge that South Africans will face. It's a challenge that Mozambicans are facing. It's a challenge that Angolans are facing. It's a challenge that every country in Africa which has gone through a physical liberation struggle is facing.
And there are sentiments, especially on social media platforms, saying that Nelson Chamisa has made himself a passenger in this process, and that the main opposition party has largely been silent. And if I can read, some of the sentiments even on this Zoom platform, there's Nokia says, BT paints a picture which does not put the MDC alliance at the center, opting instead to place emphasis on the people. But what position does he imagine for the opposition in galvanizing people in the face of ZANU-PF's onslaught? What can you say about this?
Yeah, firstly, I think the attacks on President Chamisa are unfair. He just lost his mother. And we all know what it means, what mothers mean to us. He also just lost his uncle a week ago. So I think that let's respect him and allow him to mourn his dearly beloved mother, who sacrificed a lot for him to go to school. The issue of again, there's also a very unfair attack on the role of the MTC. One of the ironies, Violet, is that if you look at the one simple organization which is taking the brunt of the insanity of Emmerson Mnangagwa, it's actually the MDC Alliance. We have had a strange court judgment handed against us in the middle of a COVID pandemic. We've had our head office taken over by the military in the middle of the night. We have had our members disproportionately, if you look at everyone who has been abducted, tortured, raped, it's disproportionate by far they are members of the MDC. On Friday, Saturday, we're in court. Fadzaima Here, our spokesperson, was in court together with some of our members. Our secretary general is in court. I'm in court. Literally everyone is in court. Our youth leaders, each one of them right now is either in hiding or in prison or out on bail. Kurawone, for instance, in Mashingo. So we have taken the brand, but we will lead and we will lead from the front. So we've got an important role to play. I, however, emphasized that every Zimbabwean must play his role. Every Zimbabwean must play a role. It's now beyond a single organization because of the brutality of the regime, the ubiquitousness of the regime. Look at what we saw on the 31st of July, 2020. There were basically policemen and soldiers literally in every street of Zimbabwe, without exception. Whether you went to Chirezi, whether you went to Odz, whether you went to Nyazura, to Todito, to Chendambuya, Tunkai, and so forth. So we need to increase the cost of the dictatorship, and every Zimbabwean citizen is an obligation to play his or her part, just like we did during the liberation struggle.
So, Mr. Mita, just a final question before I move on to the discussions and open the line so that, our viewers can also participate, because I can see a lot of people saying we want to contribute, and I'm sure they'll be able to ask some of the questions that they have for you. Bottom line, what settlement is required and what should the opposition do to mount an effective challenge to the current regime? Briefly, please.
Well, the settlement is very clear. We wrote about that in our reload, document. ZANU-PF needs genuinely to come to the table. In 2008, they didn't come genuinely to the table. Two, there must be an agreed set of reforms. I've spoken about that. Three, there must be external referee. There must be a mutually agreed mediator who, at this present moment, I don't think it will be a Zimbabwean, an eminent African, and there are many of them, including President Papa Obasanjo. Four, there must be an implementing mechanism, the National Transitional Authority, as we call it. Five, there must be an agreement on the duration of the implementation of the reform agenda. Lastly, there must be a free and fair election to restore the country to legitimacy. So it's a simple, straightforward roadmap.
Okay, and then I'll come back to you again, because I really want to know what the MDC is doing about getting to that particular kind of system that you've narrated. But let me move on and bring in our discussion. Let me start with Muleya Mwananyanda from Zambia, and she's the Deputy Regional Director for Amnesty International. Muleya, your initial thoughts, especially with all that we've heard from the panelists right now.
Thanks, Violet. Yeah, it's a pleasure to be here as a discussant, and it's almost as though this is a story that we keep talking about. And for me, I've been working on Zimbabwe for about 20 years. So the first time was covering the invasions that were happening. And I remember working then with Advocate Tawanda Hondora, and we went to the University of Zimbabwe, did loads of interviews. At that time, we were fresh-faced, and we thought, well, we're going to change things. But here we are now, 20 years later, and we're talking about the same thing. the same tactics that were used way back then are the same tactics that are being used. Speaking from the position of my organization, Amnesty International, I mean, we have documented over the years so many human rights violations that have happened in Zimbabwe, but we are seeing an escalation of the violations. And it's true that the previous speakers have spoken about Zimbabwe being open for business. Last year, we released a report, open for business, but closed for human rights, because we have seen the authorities come through to talk about the country being open for business. But during his tenure as president, Emmerson Mnangagwa has presided over a systematic and brutal crackdown on human rights, including the violent suppression of protests, a witch hunt against anyone who was dared to challenge his government. There's also a very unprecedented level of abductions and torture that we've seen of dissidents or perceived dissidents. And as Tendai was talking, there are a number of people that are still in hiding right now following the 31st July protests. So it's almost as though this is a government that is so recalcitrant, and listening to President Mnangagwa a couple of days ago saying that we will flush them out, the dissidents or even the perceived dissidents, because you don't even have to be a dissident. Sometimes it's enough for you to be perceived to be opposing the government. But using the word flush them out was such a red line for us, because to me, particularly, it sounded eerily familiar or similar to the evidence I dealt with when I worked at the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda. And it was a very scary word, flush them out. So we're at a point where it's not enough to say, well, there is fatigue. And yes, I do agree, actually, that, you know, what Stephen was saying, that Zimbabwe is not featuring very highly in high-level policy formulation of the UK. It's not just the UK. I think we've seen that happening with governments generally across the world that were previously engaged with Zimbabwe, not engaging on Zimbabwe. But it's important that changes. And I do think that there is a possibility for it to change. Corruption has been talked about by Todd, I think he spoke about that. Tendai has talked about corruption. Corruption is an important factor, because corrupt politicians use jurisdictions that are prone to secrecy, for example, to launder funds. And Zimbabwe is not immune to that. We've seen various reports that have spoken about illicit financial flows that have contributed to the collapsed economy that Zimbabwe is in now. So it's just a toxic mix of a lot of things. The triple burden of inequality, poverty, unemployment, all of that is mixed with the securocratic state that Tendai was talking about. And it's important that all of these issues are brought to the table. The last point I really want to make is how change is going to happen. So we all know in 2018, 2 years ago, Tendai, Dr. Ibo, we were sitting in the same meeting at the South African Institute for International Affairs, discussing the question about the impending elections that were coming through. And I do remember at the time, Ambassador Catriona literally refusing to look at, to engage with the discussion around human rights and how that would play into a better Zimbabwe, because she was so convinced that we needed this change and that Emmerson Mnangagwa would be the guy to to bring about this change. We were very steadfast in saying that we really wanted to see a change in the authorities' approach to human rights. So how will change happen? Yes, I do agree when Todd says that change is going to come from Zimbabweans themselves. But I also strongly agree with what Tendai said about Zimbabweans in Zimbabwe not being enough for the change that is required. We would like to have international solidarity, which is going to be a really critical factor in change in Zimbabwe. So a well-organized diaspora, Zimbabwean diaspora, but beyond the diaspora, ordinary people. So again, it can't be left to organs that have clearly failed to address some of these questions. The African Union has been seized with these matters on Zimbabwe. A number of times, the African Union has not addressed matters that are brought before it on Zimbabwe. Again, I recall my time working, interfacing with the African Union, and Zimbabwe would block any discussion on Zimbabwe. It would just not be tabled as a discussion. So the Southern African Development Community, again, as Tendai said, is very, very different from what we're seeing at ECOWAS, because there's very little, in fact, there is nothing we have heard from SADC, which is a total shame. But it is so important for President Ramaphosa, who is the current chair of the African Union, to really engage, not only because he's the chair of the African Union, but South Africa is the powerhouse here in this region. And therefore, we would expect that he would engage. And so how will that happen? I think that the increasing voices of people on the ground talking, including influential people like actors. I was very amazed to see that Jada Pinkett Smith was one of those calling for change in Zimbabwe. But ordinary people here in South Africa, in Zambia, anywhere, there will be a time when our leaders cannot ignore those people anymore. And I say this with conviction, because if people rise, which is why they're scared, which is why they're repressed, if a whole lot of people rise and call on them to do something, then something is going to have to give. And so mediation, yes, mediation will happen, but how will that happen? It will be increased and sustained campaigns from ordinary people internationally, applying the necessary pressure that is allowed, because international solidarity, I'm seeing this as a way of changing the trajectory of the downward trajectory we see now in Zimbabwe. So I think I'll end there for now.
Thanks, Malaya. Just a couple of questions. What kind of intervention can we realistically expect from a pressure group like Amnesty International? And also, I would like to read a comment that's similar to what I'm asking from Mr. Mureriwa, who says, what's Muleya's take on recent statements by Nick Mangwana in a media release today where he rubbished human rights abuses? Why can't President Mnangagwa be dragged to the International Criminal Court, for example, with all the documented evidence that Amnesty International has, for example? What can you say about this?
Thanks. Yes. So so pressure groups like Amnesty, I think we've been very consistent as Amnesty. I'm sure that the participants here and those that have been following what Amnesty has been doing will agree with me that we've been quite consistent in calling for respect, protection and fulfillment of human rights in Zimbabwe. We are going to continue to do that. But Amnesty International is just one organization. Yes, it is a global organization. We have however many millions of supporters and members that campaign on various issues, including the Zimbabwe question. But it's not enough for Amnesty International alone. It means that there have to be many more groups, and there are a lot more groups, including here in the region, in Zimbabwe itself. So what I am saying is that beyond these particular groups, we actually need people on the ground. So the protest that happened in Zimbabwe on the 31st of July gives me hope, because it was ordinary people walking on the streets, and not even in big groups, in cells sometimes, 5 people, 10 people. But that is the kind of movement that is going to grow. And at a certain point, it will be so big that it will be impossible for authorities to ignore those kinds of organizations. So that is going to, that is the sort of pressure I'm talking about. Now, in terms of international crimes, yes, the International Criminal Tribunal is the ICC is there to prosecute international crimes. I think that they have to be seized with those with those matters. And even though countries have not agreed to be part of the or have not ratified and accepted the ICC's ability to come through and do that, there is still a way in which those can be prosecuted. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Muleya. Now, let me get the views from Tiseke Kasambala, who is the chief of party for the Advancing Rights in Southern Africa program at the Freedom House. Tiseke, what is the way forward in your view? You've been covering the Zimbabwean crisis also for many years, and I've been interviewing you for the last 20 years. So from you, can we just get like your views in terms of what would make a peaceful or long-lasting settlement in Zimbabwe?
Thank you very much, Violet, and thanks to the Sapes Trust for inviting me to be a discussant on what is a very broad and deep topic. So it's a very difficult task. You are trying to advance us in terms of asking what is the way forward. And I'm going to kind of take on some of the salient points that were made by some of the presenters in terms of how we can advance this discussion. The first one I want to speak about is the issue of impunity. And all these conversations we're having right now, looking at the issues of corruption and the ongoing human rights abuses that have been taking place in Zimbabwe, cannot be addressed without kind of tackling the issue of the lack of accountability and justice for previous crimes in Zimbabwe. And Tendai Biti and I think Todd Moss spoke about the issue of reforms. There was talk about victim-led reforms and victim-led interventions. But unfortunately, when we keep talking about this issue of settlement, what I'm not seeing is how we can push for accountability and for justice to be done. And in the course of my work, I have seen that there can never be any long-term peace when you're dealing with people who perpetrated crimes. You cannot bring in the very perpetrators of crimes into negotiations and settlements. It has never worked in the long term. And so I think that's the first thing we need to talk about in Zimbabwe. How do we address the issue of accountability and justice? The second point I want to make is on paralysis. And when I talk about paralysis, I'm talking about it from both the country, a country perspective, a regional perspective, and an international perspective. Stephen Chan talked about the fact that the UK government's foreign policy on Africa was quite weak at the moment. And whilst Todd Moss said that the US government had been quite consistent in its policy and was bipartisan with its policies, what we can say is that we have not seen consistency across the board in terms of international, especially Western governments, coalescing around a consistent message on the Zimbabwe issue and calling for democracy, rule of law, and human rights as Western governments, as the international community. This also throws up for us the regional question and the regional paralysis we are seeing, in particular with President Ramaphosa. It is quite telling that after almost a week, we finally saw a message coming out from the government of South Africa on the situation in Zimbabwe. And the call should be on SADC and the AU to, at the very least, acknowledge the human rights crisis in the country and speak out against it and call for justice and accountability. There is not enough robust pressure being placed on Emmerson Mnangagwa. And we have some explanations that Tendai Biti alluded to in terms of the creeping autocracy we're seeing in other countries in the region, what we're seeing in Tanzania, Angola, et cetera. But at the same time, in so-called democratic countries like South Africa, we have seen, and to some extent, justifiably so, a lot of navel gazing and a focus on domestic issues, but without the long-term realization that those domestic issues cannot be resolved without addressing the regional questions about instability in neighboring countries such as Zimbabwe. And so that is something that really needs to be, in my opinion, addressed and tackled head on. And we are seeing the pressure coming from citizenry and citizens. And in many ways, I think this pandemic has thrown up disgruntlement in countries across the region and across the board internationally. And that is an opportune moment for civil society, for the opposition in many countries to coalesce around a message against corruption, against impunity for corruption, pushing for accountability. So let's not lose this momentum and this pressure we're seeing on Zimbabwe, which, by the way, we're also seeing here in South Africa with the corruption scandals that President Cyril Ramaphosa is facing. So there is kind of a unity around a general disgruntlement and messaging within the region about what is going on in terms of corruption and how governments on our continent and governments in the region have not taken into account the needs of the citizenry. Mm-hmm. The final point I want to make in the, I think, 20 seconds that I have is around fragmentation, and it's closely related to the issue of international solidarity and regional action. We're seeing fragmentation at all levels. And the challenge I would like to throw to the MTC and to Zimbabweans is there a moment where the various actors, and especially because we have seen civil society, we have seen the opposition, we're seeing doctors and nurses all coming out in light of the economic situation in Zimbabwe and the economic crisis and the political crisis. But I would question whether we're seeing a unified movement in Zimbabwe and that coalescing I'm talking about around the situation and pressure being placed on Emmerson Mnangagwa, albeit despite the very narrow space for civic activism. And so I think there's a need to really support, and this is a challenge to the international community and the regional community, to really support civil society in Zimbabwe that is really working hard and is at the core face of facing up to the Zimbabwean government and this regime, which has not changed at all from the previous regime. And in many ways, this is the same regime, even though we are also focusing on discussing securitization and a securitized state, which is very important. But the ZANU-PF we're seeing now is the ZANU-PF we saw 20 years ago, and it was the ZANU-PF that we saw under Mugabe. So let's provide more support for civil society organizations, because I think that they have been lost in the conversation. And let's deal with the fragmentation, which has left the various actors isolated every time they want to come out in protest. So I agree with Muleya about this idea of a broader citizen movement and support for a broader alliance of groups to put pressure on the Mnangagwa regime. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Teseke. And just a brief response to this a comment from a Malawian on Twitter, Phil Mafunda, who says, Zimbabweans are so chilled to fight. Who are we as Malawians to fight for them? Malawians protested for months until the judges and government felt people's anger. Your thoughts on this? Just a brief one before I move on to Greg and Patrick Smith and then open up the floor.
I would say that Malawians had support from the region. And I think whilst it was Malawians fighting for Malawians, and the same expectation is that the Zimbabwean citizenry will address the issue of Zimbabwe, it can't happen without regional support. So I think in a very kind of succinct manner, I'm going to say, I disagree with my brother. There's a need for regional support and regional momentum to push forward the crisis in Zimbabwe and bring an end to that crisis. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Teseke. Now, let me move to Greg Mills, who's the head of the Brenthurst Foundation based in Johannesburg. Now, Greg, I understand you'll also be representing former president, former Nigerian president Obasanjo in your brief presentation. If so, can you start by giving us reflections on both Nigeria's and the AU's positions on Zimbabwe?
Thanks very much, Violet. It's very nice to be with you here this evening. Rather like Todd Moss, I first came into contact with Sapes when I was a graduate student and then subsequently when taking students from the University of the Western Cape, where I was teaching 30 years ago, to go to Zimbabwe for South Africans learn how to do it. I think possibly we probably would avoid some of those lessons right now, which seem to be more about how not to do it. And, you know, it's always said that when people get older, and this applies to most of the familiar faces around here, they get more. Whatever you start with, it gets exaggerated. So if you're a good guy or good woman to begin with, those qualities come through, and the reverse is also true. And I think what we've seen under COVID is we've seen generally an amplification and an acceleration of whatever situation states were in. So if they're already the undergirdings of corruption or the threads of state decay, you've seen these considerably worsen in a very short accelerated time sequence. And this is, of course, not surprising in the Zimbabwe situation, given the economic conditions and political conditions that existed pre-COVID. And I think today, and I think it's a point that Stephen Chan made, that the same old games are still being played, but they're being played in a smaller and smaller, with a smaller and smaller audience, with a smaller and smaller group of people. And so when we see things in South Africa or elsewhere about settlements with farmers, $3.5 billion, people see them pretty much immediately for what they are. It's just another scheme, it's just another game in attempt to milk some money out of the system. But because of COVID, it is the same old, but it is somewhat different, because I do think the consequences are graver, the timeframes are shortened, and the world is less charitable. I think the world has less attention on Africa, as Stephen was saying, but the world, I think, is less charitable as a consequence of this. And what I'm going to say is less about what President Obasanjo was saying. I'm reflecting his role in the foundation that I work for as the chairman. And I want to talk a little bit about what happens if Zimbabwe continues on the current path. These are things that I know that he's interested in. And what is the way out of this? Because I believe that everyone would be interested in that. And I think that it's clear from being sitting in South Africa that there's incontrovertible evidence of the cost of what's been going on in South Africa in terms of the 4 million Zimbabweans that are reputed to be living within our borders. This is a daily reality for South Africans. Some of them, I think, have already been on this program. And we know very dramatically the costs of further economic implosion. We are in some ways beneficiaries of the talent of Zimbabweans, but the long-term cost is, of course, much exacerbated by the current circumstances, because it's in terms also of the cost of a lack of benefit. So the fact that Zimbabwe's economy continues its downward trajectory, that Zimbabweans are poorer virtually every day, of course, has a net negative impact on the South African economy as potentially the second biggest economy as Zimbabwe could be in the region. And of course, as the number of beneficiaries within the patronage state that is ZANU becomes smaller and smaller, of course, you risk more and more violence. And that's indeed, I think, a consequence of what we're seeing today, both inter-party, which has been in the main what we've seen, but increasingly intra-party. The second point I would make is we know pretty much what's necessary. You need some sort of negotiated solution, arrangement, which leads to a free and fair election. I think we would all be in pretty much violent agreement, not violent agreement, but violent agreement around the table on this issue. This would have to be followed by a set of micro, short-term, band-aid type economic reforms, but longer, deeper structural reforms which address the fundamental political economy, which undoes this patronage state. Myself and my colleague Jeffrey Herbst wrote about this many years ago. We called it the third liberation. Zimbabwe is still, as Tendai referred to it, in the second liberation phase, getting rid of the liberators. But the third liberation is that liberation from old ways of doing business, the old structures of the economy, the kind of very elite-based political economy where a set of white guys was replaced by a set of black guys at independence. We also know, I believe, and we've heard this, I think, today more from Stephen than Todd, is that this negotiated settlement is not going to come from the United Kingdom, no matter the bogeyman image that is portrayed sometimes in the Zimbabwean media and in the politics of the UK, or in the same way of the United States. It's not going to even come from Russia or China for different sets of reasons, but they're not interested in this either. It's probably not going to come from the AU, although it should, and it's probably not going to come from SADC, who are at best underwhelming rather than using the opportunity to seize leadership in Southern Africa. But like with Rhodesia, like with Ian Smith's Rhodesia, this is probably going to have to come from South Africa itself. And South Africa will have to display an element of leadership. And I think the question has to be about what's the likelihood of change in South Africa's policy right now. And there's some negative signs and some positive signs. I believe the negative signs is that the ANC still sees threats in terms of the way in which Zimbabwe is portrayed domestically. It sees the Zimbabwe situation and ZANU-PF still from within its own domestic political prism, and liberation politics and liberation ties and liberation mythology has trumped human rights. It's even trumped economic self-interest in this regard, if you consider that Zimbabwe's economic implosion is not in our evident self-interest. So, and also, and I borrow Tendai's words in this regard, South Africa has learned from the state capture model very well that Zimbabwe once provided, and we are busy feasting. In fact, we can barely take our eyes off the COVID pot of money at the moment to turn our attention elsewhere. So those are the negative signs, but there are some positive signs of change. I think it's more difficult, and there's an awareness in South Africa, and I was listening only to the Secretary General of the ANC in this regard last night. It's more difficult for South Africa to stand for prosperity in isolation from the region. We have to do this together. If we think about the benefits of small things to ourselves, they have very big impact at home. Just think fixing Beit Bridge, what the impact that would be on the South African economy, for example. But we can't project a image of prosperity and a series of policies which aim at that in ignoring Zimbabwe. We can't also wait for the worst to happen in Zimbabwe, because we could get Syria on our doorstep. These things you can't simply wish away. There are severe consequences to state failure, one of which is it's so difficult to repair over the long term. And of course, we're not going to get any of the positive benefits that we so desperately need in our own economy, in which employment is now nearly 50% as a consequence of failure of ANC policies on the one hand, and the structural inheritance of apartheid on the other, and now COVID. So those three triple whammies together have led to a dire economic situation of 10 years of lost growth. And then, of course, the IMF loan that South Africa has just taken, and the fact that we are borrowing much more heavily from in the international community, makes us more vulnerable to external influences. And let me just conclude with three brief points. We know from South Africa's own settlement that you need three broad ingredients to make settlements happen. You need an awareness internally that there's more to be gained by settlement than by continuing on the path that you're on. And I think you have to ask yourself, is ZANU-PF in that position? Are the costs of continuing on this path sufficiently high enough for ZANU to want to sue for peace? The second one, and this really speaks to what Todd and Stephen were chatting about, is the need for external consensus in pushing the different parties to the table. Is the whole international community using all the tools at their disposal to push the parties to the table? And then, of course, what Tendai mentioned, you need leadership. You need someone who can do this. You need someone who can, if necessary, broker this. You need timing and you need method. But I would say, at least from a South African vantage, given the heating or the brewing storm in South Africa's own economy, that the moment is increasingly ripe. It may not be ripe enough yet, but it's increasingly ripe for South Africa to take a much harder look at what's going on in Zimbabwe and try and find a way to address this, without which we are, I think, increasingly feel we could not only suffer the consequences of no benefit, but suffer the consequences of failure. And the very importantly, and this is my very last point, the weakening of the image of the ANC in terms of that liberation ethos and mythology. The fact that people are being so clearly and openly and regularly abused and their human rights trampled in Zimbabwe does affect the ANC. And that's, I think, the most powerful point to be made in this engagement. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Greg. Just one question, and that would be, how far then are we from a situation in which South Africa will push for a settlement in Zimbabwe, in your view?
Well, I think it's brewing. I think the parties in Zimbabwe have to steer that debate in South Africa. And if it's not going to be ZANU-PF, and I don't see why there's going to be any interest in them to do that yet, at least, it's going to have to be the MDC who takes a position of the moral high ground, as it were, in terms of finding a way forward for some sort of transitional arrangement leading to those elections and making that point clear. So it's not one thing, Violet. I think it's going to be a series of pressures and a series of opportunities. But I would argue that COVID has probably almost definitely increased the chances of some sort of transitional arrangement, some sort of settlement, rather than worsened them. Undoubtedly, things are probably going to get nastier before they get better, because that's the nature of such regimes. But certainly, I think South Africa is feeling the effects of its failure in Zimbabwe.
Okay. No, thank you very much for that, Greg Mills. Our last speaker is Patrick Smith, and then we will allow some of the viewers on Zoom to contribute. Now I see we have more than 400 people watching on Zoom right now, and quite a few have expressed they want to contribute. So you can start raising your hands, and as soon as Patrick Smith is finished, then we can start bringing in some of you to contribute. Patrick Smith from the Africa Report and Africa Confidential. So much has been said, but maybe from you, if you can just give us your thoughts in terms of what you think now is the way forward for Zimbabwe. And you've been writing about Zimbabwe for many years also.
Thanks, Violet. Perhaps I most usefully could talk about what I've seen as a reporter running around Africa over the years, looking at transitions in a range of different places, Nigeria, Ghana, where both transitioned out of military regimes into multi-party open political systems. Also Liberia, Sierra Leone, transiting from a war zone to again, civilian multi-party regimes, South Africa, of course, which is sort of sui generis in its own way. But most recently, and I was saying this to Dr. Mandaza yesterday, Sudan, I think, offers, despite being a very different country from Zimbabwe in so many ways, and I don't think either the National Islamic Front regime nor ZANU-PF would relish anyone comparing the two regimes. I think they do have something in common. And moving the way that the Sudanese opposition galvanized over 30 years of dictatorship, essentially from 89 to last year, and what they did with that massive demonstration, 500,000 people gathered outside the military defense headquarters in Khartoum. And to give you a sense of what they were up against, the Sudan regime presided under the National Islamic Front regime under Omar al-Bashir, presided over the deaths of 2 million people in South Sudan, and at least 1 million people in various wars in Numa Mountains, Kordofan, Darfur, and so on within Sudan. So it was one of the most ruthless regimes up there with Saddam Hussein and Bashar al-Assad. And the Sudanese put together this opposition. I think there's an awful lot that can be gained from looking at what they did. Extremely disciplined, avowedly non-violent. There was just no point in being violent because there was no way, even with the numbers, you were going to be able to confront the Sudanese military and intelligence services. And having then formed, and what was really interesting was the way they formed alliances with dissidents within the Sudanese military who realized that what Bashir had done was lead the country into a very bloody cul-de-sac. And it was just going to get worse and worse for successive generations after him. As a 78-year-old, and I think Mnangagwa was 77, he had no real interest in the future more than a few more years, essentially, as running the country. So I think there's something to really be gained in what they did and how they then triggered this negotiating process in Sudan, which is not so far away from what is being talked about in Zimbabwe as this national transitional authority. So just to be very quick, I'd say the key things that have come out of what happened in Sudan that might be relevant for Zimbabwe is that the key participants were the people, the civil society organizations, the trades unions played a major role, the professional associations, the Doc Sudan Doctors Association, one is one of the leading lights in the opposition movement, just as it has been in some respects in Zimbabwe. You have a very similar corpus of professional, responsible professionals in civil society organized, the workers' organizations and so on, above and beyond the parties. No disrespect to the MDC and the other opposition parties who, as Tendai has said, have endured a hell of a lot just to stay in business as political entities. But the issue in Sudan was that there was a much wider range of activism drawing from the streets and the communities, and that really really put pressure on the government and finding ways of making alliances, weird alliances, but alliances nevertheless, with dissidents within the military, within the police, to get political change. And that's what they started when they pushed out Omar al-Bashir in April 2019 and started this process of change. So I don't think it's beyond the wit of the political entities in Zimbabwe to do that. But I think it takes looking at what happened in Sudan as the possibility of drawing on some useful examples from there.
So Patrick, is the NCP the kind of like Sudan movement that Zimbabwe needs?
So the NCP. For Zimbabwe. Yeah. Well, I mean, I think there are similarities. Yes, I mean, because what the Sudan revolution, well, they regard themselves as revolutionaries because they were overthrowing not just a regime, but a way of running government. And they started very much with these grassroots committees in the regions, organizing on a community and street basis, bringing people not just together for sort of making political judgments, but also saying, okay, you've got a health emergency here. Let's talk to the guy down the street who's got a small pharmaceutical company, get some drugs to that community, providing benefits. It wasn't just politics. It was a material benefit. Teachers and university lecturers had a responsibility to work with communities. And it was all part of this revolutionary movement. So I think it's, yes, I think that goes into revitalizing civil society and making sure it's autonomous and it has its own agenda and can really contribute to the process of change alongside the established political parties and whatever other entities are in the mix.
Okay, no, thank you very much for that, Patrick Smith. So now I'd like to take some contributions, questions, comments from the floor. We have quite a number of people who have raised their hands. So please ask you to keep your contributions very brief. And I also ask the panelists to keep their answers very brief because we need to finish by 7 o'clock or 8 o'clock in Zimbabwe time. So I'll just go from the top going down. Who is the first one there? Just a sec, I've just lost my chat. I think it's Sherman Ban. Nope. Just bear with me. Chorus Nyamakunda. Can you unmute?
Yes. First of all, I would like to respond to Patrick Smith. Patrick Smith, the methods you are talking about Sudan and other countries, the ZANU-PF government, the Zimbabwe government is fully aware. The Zimbabweans have tried that. I think there are other methods that involve not letting blood. There are other methods that can be used. That's my response to that. Whatever organization trying to try, the government would still be fully aware. You can't do anything secret without the government knowing. And number two, getting back to Greg Mills, when the ANC came to power, they had more than two-thirds majority, so they had absolute power to do anything. The change of politics in South Africa, which you mentioned, is it denting the ANC and also the opposition parties in South Africa? Are they speaking with the same voice? Is the Zimbabwean issue an issue for those opposition parties? Thank you.
Thank you. I'll take two more for now, and then we'll get the panelists to respond. So panelists, please, can you keep a note of the questions that you've been asked, and then you can come and respond towards the end. The next one is Oswald Moyo. Can you unmute Oswald?
Yes, I've done so. Thank you, Violet. Actually, I think I have a contribution. I think the people of Zimbabwe generally, they underestimate the history of ZANU-PF and how actually ZANU-PF got into power. From 1980, you realize that the 1980 elections were disputed and were contested. And up to date, we don't know who won the election. They purport Robert Mugabe, but some Ziprakada still say, no, Joshua Nkomo won the elections. That's why up to date, even in the National Archives, we don't have the ballot box or the ballot papers, I mean to say. They went away with Lord Soames. So firstly, the election thing has failed for a long time to resolve the Zimbabwean crisis of governance. And on another important issue, I believe that the opposition itself has not been strong. It has been weakened within, and whenever the opposition try to make maybe strides and reforms within itself, it is penetrated. Of recent, we have seen the Kupe Munzura function. Also, after the demise of Dr. Morgan Richard Tsvangirai, but actually the opposition also has even lost the organic intellectuals that it used to have. These included the workers. So now the opposition, actually, when we look from its founding grounds, it has also lost the gist with the people. And if you look largely, the marginalized communities, especially the peasants, they do not know the ideology of the opposition. So I believe it's high time also the opposition in Zimbabwe should conscientize the people. They have tried of recent to do that, but I believe there is more to this that they should do. And I believe everyone knows that the Zimbabwean situation has just reached an alarming level, and people need leadership to fight. So we lack real leadership from the opposing political parties, okay, because they are divided. So that's what I generally think is the problem, which also must be.
Thank you, Oswald. We'll get Tendai Biti to respond to that. Next, Sherman Bana.
Hi, thank you. I hope you can hear me. I just want to refer to the last speaker who spoke about the Sudanese case. Firstly, we've got to really, really understand when we do comparisons, different socioeconomic cases. In Sudan, we've got a very, very small middle class. And so a lot of people were predominantly on the same level and had very, really nothing to lose and could take to the streets and demonstrate in a way, whether it was peaceful or violent. What we have in Zimbabwe is a vast difference in classes. Okay, and that's due to the large diaspora kind of base. So you get a lot of people who have a lot to lose, and that's a reality on the ground. You've got people, you spoke about certain professionals and doctors and pharmaceuticals who could contribute to the local community and whatever the case may be. In Zimbabwe, we've got certain people of certain caliber who have so much to lose for looking after the next caliber that it's very impractical to be united. So we've got so many classes of people who look out for their own benefit, and that's why cohesion in any sense of opposition is so far-fetched. That's number one. So uniting as an opposition to any kind of government or any kind of dictatorship is very, very difficult because of this, the vast differences in benefit and the vast difference in class. And that's a dynamic that we can't control due to our diaspora community. That's number one. The second thing that I wanted to add was, that's it for now.
Thank you. Thank you, Sherman. And in this round, I'll take one more from Edison Kapondo. Edison, can you unmute? We can't, okay.
Ali?
Yes.
Good evening.
Hi, Edison, we can hear you.
I think what I can say from my own point of view is for most people to understand our situation here in Zimbabwe, and to contribute sustainably, we really need to understand where we are coming from, where we are, and the most effective thing which can be done, whilst you are focusing on where we are coming from and where we are right now. If we are to think of, we literally don't have like any industry running at the moment, and there's no need for us at this particular moment to have a currency which is called a Zimbabwean dollar. It's just kind of a form of currency which is simply disturbing the pattern, which is simply disturbing the entire economics of the nation. And what kind of people are we dealing with? Then we go back to the grassroots. What can we do as a Zimbabwe effectively, collectively, to fight against our common enemy? Thank you.
Thank you, Edson. So let me start with Tendai Biti. The question from Oswald about the opposition, he seems to say the opposition needs to do more and that there's lacking real leadership. What can you say about that briefly, please?
Look, I think there's a lack of appreciation of the role of an opposition. We can't go ahead of the people. If we go ahead of the people, we leave them suspended. If we go ahead of the people, we expose them to a particularly brutal regime. We saw what it did on the 1st of August, 2018. We saw what it did in January, 2019. So our role, and we've been doing this, is to steer the ship to confront in such a way that we are able to remain standing the morning after, because we know of ZANU-PF. It is the same party that killed our people, 30,000, during a Gugura wound. Over the years, we have led the protest, we have led the struggle. You remember from the days of the final push, the days of March 2007, 11 March 2007, the violence which we took in 2008. And sometimes we don't provide direct leadership. We work through and with other organizations. What I want to say, particularly connected to, I think it was Sherman, is that firstly, the MDC Alliance is a huge, humongous organization. And don't make the mistake of judging it from the top, from the challenges which we're having with the likes of Kupe and Monzora. Judge it from the ground, how organic this movement is, and what a huge, humongous mass organization it is. Secondly, I beg to differ with Sherman when he says that there are Zimbabweans with a lot of to lose, and therefore you will not have a homogeneous response to the crisis. First, let's separate ZANU-PF and the likes of Mnangagwa, the small elite that you find in these cartels, and they're not more than 40 people. They're not more than 40 people that you'll find in all these huge companies. They're not more than 40 people. The rest of the Zimbabweans, including the middle class, including people who own business, are carrying the huge burden brought by ZANU-PF, the burden of illegitimacy, the burden of incompetence, the burden of extractiveness, the burden of predatoriness. So we had that stage, which the left would call the National Democratic Revolution, the National Democratic stage, where we are all in it together. It doesn't matter whether you're middle class, it doesn't matter whether you own a business, it doesn't matter whether you are a student, it doesn't matter whether you are a peasant. And that's why I said in my address, there's an obligation on all of us Zimbabweans to provide the agency. But of course, the MDC must take the lead. And I have no doubt that we've been taking the lead. That's why, even in things that we're not involved directly, look at 31st July 2020. We didn't call for it, but Chinamasa in his response, ZANU-PF in his response, it targeted the MDC Alliance because it knows how organic and how powerful this organization is.
Okay, thanks, Tendai. Greg and Patrick, I'll come back to you. In fact, what I will do, I'll come back to all the panelists just now to just give us, you know, your final words. And then Greg and Patrick, you'll also include your responses to the questions that you asked, because I'm running out of time and there are so many people who have raised their hands. So I need to take at least a few more before we come to the final words. Ephraim Mubai, please, can we at least, we know already what the problems are. Let's try and stick to the theme of this discussion today. What is the way forward? So let's not go back and talk about the problems. We know what they are. Please, if you don't have, you know, specific solutions or comments to do with the topic, I will have to mute you to mute your mic. So Ephraim, please go ahead. Ephraim Mbai. Okay, I think we've lost Ephraim. Godfrey Mutindi.
Thanks so much. My question is in two parts. Hello?
Yes, we can hear you. Go ahead. Can you make
my question is in two parts. Mm-hmm. The first of all on Mr. I think it's Mr. Moss. He started at the issues of governance in Zimbabwe, democracy, human rights. He did not start where Zidera is. Let's be honest in our analysis. Zidera has got two premises, which is one, Zimbabwe is a threat to the US interests. And then two, Zimbabwe was supposed to compensate the white farmers according to the SADC tribunal. That's what the document says. And all these other issues of democracy and human rights come later. So let's discuss things as they are. We are researchers and we are professionals. Second thing, I'm asking about the compensation for the white farmers, the 3.5 billion that is being reported that Zimbabwe is going to compensate the white farmers. Could that be also an issue that we are supposed to discuss here in that one there? How are the partners involved, the cooperation partners in the international
community? These are really good questions, but we really have run out of time. And what we wanted from people in this section is just to tell us what needs to happen now. So I'm sorry, that we'll have to bring in another conversation. So let me get one more from the floor. Basically, we want to know what is the way forward. So if anyone has that, Dominique Mutanga.
Yeah, thanks, Violet. Just two-part question for Tendai Biti, who spoke about the military. You say that they brought up some concerns in 2007 prior to the GNU. My question is, if the military, as we know, are the power brokers, has there been any efforts to engage them directly to discuss the way forward, the resettlement? And then number two, what happened to those military guys that you spoke to? Are they dead? Are they alive? And if they are alive, why can we not engage them as part of the resettlement? Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for that, Dominique. And I'm afraid we just have too many hands raised right now and not enough time. So I'm really sorry about that, ladies and gentlemen, but I need to go and get final comments from the panelists. And in your final comments, please, can you at least just tell us what you think is the way forward in just a minute and a half and not more than that, so that we can then end with the convener of this discussion, Dr. Mandaza, with last words. So let me start with Todd Moss.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Violet. Look, on the Zidera question, I'm going to paste into chat the link to Zidera. Everyone should read it for themselves. It's four pages. It's very clear. The United States, you know, there's not one American citizen who's had a farm stolen. So the idea that the U.S. government, the policy towards Zimbabwe is about white farmers is just wrong. So I'll share that so everyone can see. Look, the international community, including the United States, stands ready to support a genuine reform process in Zimbabwe. But given the behavior of the government over the past 10 years, we will not underwrite anything that leads to more theft and more repression. Opposition parties and civil society is so important that they have to continue to speak up and stand up, and that's where the international community will support them. It is not for the United States or Britain or Europeans or the Chinese to dictate terms of a negotiation. you know, I wish that the AU would play that role, but I'm not very optimistic. So whatever process that is, Zimbabwe is going to need resources and support. And the US and others are ready to do that, but not in a way that's going to make things worse rather than better. Those are my comments, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to talk to everyone. So thank you, Ibo, thank you, Violet, and all of the panelists and commenters.
Thank you, Todd Moss. And Professor Stephen Chan?
Okay. Thank you very, very much. Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can.
Okay. It's been a pleasure to participate on this panel. I agree with what the other speakers have said in that the final breakthrough, the final solution, if there is one for Zimbabwe, has got to be led by Zimbabweans. However, this is not just Zimbabweans who live in Zimbabwe. Many millions have had to leave Zimbabwe. So what you need is a unified movement. I'm not really sure that the opposition parties have reached out sufficiently to the Zimbabwean diaspora internationally. There's at least 1 million of them here in the United Kingdom, about 4 million at least in South Africa. You come across them in many, many countries and other parts of Africa, uniting them into a major pressure group. In other words, these are people who put pressure on their host governments to put pressure on Zimbabwe. So unifying the diaspora as a key part of civil society, not just concentrating on an internal civil society, but international civil society, using electronic civil society mechanisms, which I reiterate the opposition has not been very good at doing so far. That I think is going to be a key and critical part of going forward in the future. There's one other very controversial way which requires, as it were, some backroom, back channels diplomacy. That is that if we're going to be brutally honest, we talk about the securocrats in Zimbabwe. I actually have very grave doubts about their military capacity and military professionalism in a real conflict situation. So using the good offices of senior military people from other countries, preferably other African countries, to talk to them about what true military professionalism means, this could be a very interesting adjunct back channel. But the primary channel for change has really got to be by civil society, international Zimbabwean civil society.
Okay. All right. No, thank you very much, Professor Stephen Chan. Tendai Biti. Tendai? I think you
have. Yes, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Three points are critical, Violet. The first one is that there has to be the agency of Zimbabweans across the length and breadth of our society, and including compatriots in the diaspora. I think convergence is coming. We are seeing signs of it. The Zimbabwean Lives Matter, movement. Something is brewing. Something is being born. The MDC Alliance will play its part. It has always played its part. It will provide the necessary leadership. Number two, it is the external refereeing, the role of the international community, particularly the region, particularly South Africa. Third is the obligation that we need to bring ZANU-PF to the table. In my respectful view, I don't think it's going to be possible under Emmerson Mnangagwa. I suspect that any possible dialogue can only take place after Emmerson Mnangagwa is gone, but that dialogue must focus on reform. That dialogue must create an implementation mechanism. That dialogue must include to an implementation period, which will then lead to free and fair elections. It can be done. We've done it before. We didn't do a good job. But I think there will be change in this country sooner rather than later.
Okay, thank you, Tendai Biti from the MDC. Muleya Mwananyanda.
Oh, thank you very much. So my last point is where I ended, that international solidarity is going to be important in order to change this. Yes, from Zimbabweans, but Zimbabweans cannot do it alone. We're going to have to work very, very hard to get people across the region, across other countries to be part of this. So in whatever way we can, those people on this call, those of us working in the organizations we work, we must reach out to other people to be part of the movement.
Thank you, Mulea. Tiseke Kasambala.
Thanks, Violet. Sorry, I was trying to unmute. My final point is that any discussions around negotiations and settlements must not be limited to political settlements alone, but must be premised on human rights, must be premised on democracy and governance, but also move beyond and engage the Zimbabwean citizenry, be widely consultative, engage civil society organizations as well. And most importantly, must specifically address the issues of accountability and justice in Zimbabwe. Finally, I would like to say that even though there is regional paralysis when it comes to African governments and regional governments in Southern Africa, regional support remains key. And this moment provides an opportunity. There is momentum in countries like South Africa, and there is support from COSATU, from South African citizens and others within the region across Southern Africa for democracy and human rights in Zimbabwe. And so let's take advantage of that opportunity. Let's take advantage of the momentum.
Thank you very much, Tiseke. And Greg Mills?
Myself. Thank you very much. I'll try to unmute myself. Just very briefly on the question about opposition politics in South Africa, the two major opposition movements, which is the opposition lead or the official opposition, the Democratic Alliance, has nearly 21% of votes in South Africa, and the Economic Freedom Fighters, the EFF, nearly 11%. So that together is nearly 32% of the vote. And of course, they take a very strong line, albeit from different perspectives, on Zimbabwe. Julius Malema has been particularly outspoken on this issue recently. South African government's interested in things that make them look bad, and interested in things that make them look weak, and interested in acting against issues or for issues that are to do with jobs and the economy. And that's why their support has been driven down to just 57% of the electorate. Really, it's about a combination of corruption and economic performance. My last point I would make is, and sorry, Zimbabwe plays into those two issues of corruption and economic performance, is COVID has created a slightly different, not a slightly, a very different world, different circumstances, even in Zimbabwe. It's created undoubtedly in the short term opportunities to eat. And we've seen that here in South Africa, and it's also been the case in Zimbabwe. But it's dramatically increased the costs and speed of failure. And as the sign behind me suggests, don't let a crisis go to waste. And that's something that the opportunity in Zimbabwe should not do. They need to be voluble. They need to propose a series of dialogues, and they need to make a plausible case for transition to something better for Zimbabweans.
Thank you, Greg Mills. And from our last speaker, Patrick Smith. Patrick, you have to unmute.
I'm trying to, yes. Yeah. I think that's working now. Okay. Yeah, fine. I just got a message about the Sudan thing again, which has prompted some interest and maybe criticism as well. One caller said that he thought the parallel between Zimbabwe was closer with the Egyptian revolution than the Sudanese revolution. I'd say, yeah, definitely from a sort of socio-political analysis, there are, you know, closer parallels with the sort of Nasserite nationalist regime in Egypt than there are with the Islamist regime in Sudan. The point being that what happened in Egypt was tragic because the people got onto the streets, demanded political change, they got some backing from the military, they kicked out Mubarak, and then they had an Islamist regime that failed, and now they've got a dictator who's as bad as Mubarak, probably worse. So what the Sudanese are trying to do by having this extended transition to talk about...
You have to be brief because
I'm just saying, just sort of the Sudanese again experiment shows, I mean, the importance of this idea that everyone in Zimbabwe has been talking about, this transitional authority that can actually start to change institutions and start to change the society, but more importantly, bring the entire society together into that process of debate, argument, and institutional renewal. And I think that that's, you know, a more coherent and effective way forward.
Thanks. Thank you very much, Patrick. And I'm afraid we've run out of time. So let me bring in Dr. Ibo Mandaza. Dr. Mandaza, I think you only have a minute.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
I'll have 2 minutes. I think this has lived up to the expectations. And I'll have occasion to thank the panelists and the discussants at the end. I think we have established a viable link between the national, regional, and international perspectives on Zimbabwe. And we hope that in the future, we can actually galvanize that linkage through the kind of people that we have on the panel and through them to put pressure towards some kind of settlement in Zimbabwe. Secondly, I think the role of South Africa has been quite central. I know that this afternoon I had an interview with one of the TV stations, and unfortunately before they didn't know I was listening, but I had complaints that, well, Zimbabweans, why are they bothering South Africans? They should do their own thing, you know? They should do enough to free themselves. And I want to just remind ourselves, but also in the context of the discussion, the role of the international community. I pointed out during the discussion that in South Africa, without the global movement, the anti-apartheid movement, there may not have been liberation in South Africa. There may not be democracy in South Africa. So we cannot underestimate the role of the international community, the global community, the African, the continental effort. Nigerians, for example, raised $1 each, $1 each to support the struggle in Southern Africa. So I think that also refers to our discussion today. Thirdly, I think we have learned as Zimbabweans the need to define, refine, and present a settlement model that we want. Tendai spoke a lot about it, but I think we need, even through the NCP, the civic society, the diaspora, to refine this concept of the transition authority as necessary so that we are ready for it when it comes up. Last but not least, I think we want to call upon the international community and South Africa in particular, the region SADC, to stop the violence, the abductions, the torture in Zimbabwe. That doesn't require a meeting. Let Emmerson Mnangagwa's counterparts phone him. Let the British Prime Minister, the State Department in the US, just make it known that the violence, the abductions, the torture of young activists should stop immediately. I wish now again to thank the panelists, Todd, Stephen, Tendai, Mulea, Seke, Greg, and Patrick. Thank you very much indeed. You really made a difference to this session. I think it will be a memorable one. 400 or more on Zoom, thousands on Facebook. Thank you very much. And thanks to Violet. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ibo Mandaza. And we have come to the end of our broadcast. Thanks to all our panelists, discussants, and contributors. We are sorry we weren't able to get as many of you in the call, but next time. And this broadcast, as you've heard from Dr. Mandaz, is brought to you by the Sapes Trust Policy Dialogue Forum. My name is Violet Gonda. Have a good night. You were listening to the Sapes Trust Policy Dialogue Forum. Oh, my God.